for coming for this evening's talk, and thanks NCBS and the Archives Project for inviting me. I just want to start straight away with what I hope to share with you. I suppose most of us are agreed that we are going through very trying times as a people, and for many of us who are engaged in conversations to do with history or with memory or with identity or community, these conversations are proving to be increasingly difficult to have. And very polarized opinions emerge in the course of these conversations, and some of us are just unwilling to listen to certain points of view, and this was particularly evident around the downreading of Article 370 in Kashmir. And as a late civil rights activist, Dr. Balagopal used to say, Kashmir is the litmus test for Indian liberals, and sadly many of us failed that test, and that to me is the height of our unwillingness to heed another point of view, if not anything more than that, and to sort of resort to extremely aggressive arguments to something that we don't even wish to countenance. So in that context, I thought I would like to share with you a set of initiatives comprising acts and conversations that might help us all to speak with greater calm, greater pause, and with a bit of tentativeness, and not be so completely convinced of what we are saying all the time. And the three instances that I wish to address are familiar ones for many of us. One is the moment of Me Too, which sad to say is celebrating its second anniversary without too much progress made in any direction. The second has to do with communal hatred and its consequences, and here I want us all to remember Gujarat 2002 all over again. And the third has to do with state-fueled prejudice in an international sense. And here I want to look at the history of Indonesia in the 1960s. And hopefully, as I speak, I will be able to connect these three stories so that we can sort of learn from different histories and different geographies as to how we might engage in meaningful conversations around issues that many of us have strong opinions about, but which shouldn't then lead consequently to us holding very polarized views, or worse, hurting each other in ways that cannot be taken back anymore. So thanks once again. So since this is part of an archive lecture series, I want to make a gesture about towards the idea of the archives itself. And here I want to speak of how memory itself is an archive in some ways. It provides us the means, the impressions, the words, the images to structure our ours. It has a bearing on our sensory as well as cerebral experiences, on our emotions and thoughts. So in a sense, memory shapes our sense of self in rather fundamental ways. And we may not be aware of it because much of it translates into routine and habit. So what we do of a day may actually be linked back to a memory of something we've heard or experienced, or which came to us as ritual or custom, or which came to us as belief that we can, or which came to us as a kind of Lakshman Rekha we shouldn't cross. So memory functions in very intangible ways, and I think more than ever it's important to sort of consider what sort of an archive is memory, and how may we sort of relate to memory, because memory is also very fragile, it's very susceptible. So, you know, and as the poet T.S. Eliot said, humankind cannot bear too much reality, and when that happens, memory packs up, it sort of morphs into trauma, it does not want to remember certain things, or it cannot say certain things. So memory is fragile, it's susceptible, and when we say it's susceptible to prejudice, it's susceptible to hatred, and in such cases memory becomes a complete wall against which you can knock and nothing comes of it, and that wall can move and crush those who dare to sort of knock too hard. And that we see in abundance in this country and in other parts of the world, where those who have strong views to hold on to without wanting to think through them or to listen to others that challenge them, you find that they are capable of great aggression, great haste, and much hurt. So memory works in very many different ways. So what I want to do today is, using these three instances, talk of what memory does or does not do for us, and how that is consequential for how we live, who we are, and most important, how we relate to other human beings. And I'm going to do this by taking myself and all of you through these three instances. And I will start with Me Too, and I think many of us who followed the Me Too story since it happened 2 years ago know that in terms of the actual justice or in terms of how society has engaged with the Me Too movement, sad to say, very little has come of it in a productive sense. Some of us have gone to court only to find that you're greeted with a great amount of hostility against whom, by those who have come to defend their honor and their names. Some of us have spoken and found that you find that people don't want to listen to stories about men in powerful places or those who hold powerful positions or those who we consider our comrades, those who are purportedly progressive. So it's been a kind of a dead end for many people who've been part of the Me Too campaigns and agitations. So in this context, I think memory has an important role to play, because perhaps one way of thinking through the last 2 years is also to ask ourselves, how did it all start? And that question takes us to the United States, and it takes us not to where we think it started, which is Hollywood, but to actually the African American community and to the work of African American feminists, and in particular Tarana Burke, an African American woman who had been subject to abuse herself and who was working with other young women from the community and from other colored communities to create safe spaces for girls, especially very young girls, to come to terms with abuse and violence. And this was abuse and violence that emerged from within familial, intimate, and community spaces. And it was often very difficult to talk about these acts of violence because you had to name people that were close to you. You had to name people that would implicate families and communities. And in some cases, you were actually stopped from doing so in the interests of community honor at large. And since within the African American communities and the history of racism in the United States, there's been this powerful construction and reconstruction of the African American male as a sexual predator. So in order not to contribute to the perpetration of that kind of a stereotype, there was a lot of internal censorship that African American women and girls were expected to practice. And in that context, Tarana Burke and some others ran this pedagogic initiative where they could work with young girls, not so much to get them to talk about violence, but to experience a sense of self-worth. And in the course of that, they discovered that there were many terrible experiences that these young women wanted to share, and they didn't have a name for those experiences, and that is when they sent out a note saying, you don't all have to speak, just write Me Too if you wish to. And that became the basis not only for judicial action, but also to think about how a hurt, terrorized, and racially differentiated minority, when it turns inwards, can also turn extremely aggressive and violent towards its own kind. So how do you then think about race? How do you think about sexuality? And how do you think about justice? Do you think about justice in terms of the individual victim of violence? Do you think about justice in a larger social and racial sense, given that the largest number of people incarcerated in the prisons of the United States are African Americans? So these were questions that emerged in the wake of such conversations, leading another African American feminist to write recently in the New York Times that looking back on the Me Too years, she says, Me Too survivors, and I'm quoting her, this is Loretta Ross, I believe Me Too survivors can more effectively address sexual abuse without resorting to the punishment and exile that mirror the prison industrial complex. And this is an important thing for us to think through. If you all remember the sort of anger that was on the streets in the context of the violence against the person that we now call Nirbhaya. And there were calls for the imposition of capital punishment, there were calls for vengeance, and even today, should an act of terrible sexual violence take place, there are voices that call out for capital punishment and vengeance. And we don't pause to ask ourselves, what are we actually saying when we make these claims? And more recently, too, in another celebrated case of a writer, Dasengoy, Mohammed Farooqi, who was accused of sexual violence, a group of feminists spoke of how one may not want to resort to what she called, what they called carceral justice, a justice that is only defined by extreme punishment in the prisons. I mean, these are all debatable issues. But the point is that sexual justice is not a simple matter of name calling, though name calling is very important in contexts where you cannot speak of these matters within the spaces that you habitually inhabit, and where you need to find other spaces to actually say, this person I trusted as a teacher, this person I trusted as a comrade, has actually been extremely unmindful of my feelings, has imposed himself on me in ways that I did not imagine. So I think to say those things and to name people is important, but sadly we haven't been able to sort of go beyond naming and shaming except to the courts. That's the way our criminal justice system works, and that's what we are left with, given the fact that internal adjudication systems don't work as well as they ought to. They are not discretionary, they are not imaginative. So you have this situation of where you have to come out in public and say something and then face the consequences, or you resort to the criminal justice system, which is extremely unfriendly to the victim. In the case of one woman who dared to take on a senior media person who is now with the ruling party, the man comes to court with 90 lawyers. And what is this poor woman expected to do? And that's intimidation of a kind that we can't even begin to imagine. So given all these facts, what do African American experiences have to teach us? And I think there are two things that are important. One is that the process of thinking about sexual violence has to be nuanced and differentiated. So there's a lot of violence that happens on the streets. The victims are undifferentiated by caste or class in some cases. Sometimes they are marked by caste and class and religion in other cases. So maybe then apply the same yardstick to all cases. The law does. The law only recognizes particular acts of violence. It does not recognize context. It does not recognize history, which is why it's able to get away with acts, which is why perpetrators are able to get away with acts that are seriously criminal. So the non-recognition of context and history in law doesn't mean that we don't work with the judicial system, but that we work with the judicial system with the full knowledge that it is limited. And therefore we do other things. We do creative pedagogy, we work with women who faced violence, we speak to them, we build up a culture of mindful listening, and if there are differences, we learn to find and work our way through a language where we can communicate and not sort of impale ourselves on extreme positions from where there's no dialogue that's possible. And Loretta Ross points out how in the 1970s African American women actually ran a project which took them to meet men who had assaulted other women, African American women, in prison, and listened to their stories of how they came to do the things that they eventually did. And many men did own up to raping women. And then their stories were equally heartbreaking, where they came from, where they grew up, what they had to countenance while growing up, the kinds of dysfunctional homes that they emerged out of, without exonerating these acts of violence, these acts of injustice. How do we build meaningful conversations? So that's something that you can learn from the African American community and make that as a moment to recover certain features of our own lost memory about feminist activism in this country. I mean, groups that emerged in the Indian context in the late 70s and 80s across India, especially in the major metropolitan centers, did build a culture of listening. So much so that, you know, like Freud said, listening can be a form of epistemology itself. It can build up a certain way of thinking about knowledge. It's a form of knowledge itself. How you listen matters a lot. And I think feminist groups worked a lot at listening. They used to do what was then called casework, where women would drop in, come in, women from different social backgrounds, different religious backgrounds, caste backgrounds. If they have faced an extremely unpleasant situation at home or outside that they cannot speak of elsewhere. And over years, a culture of listening and comradeship was built up in these groups. But these are sadly not part of official feminist histories. Official feminist histories record our engagement with the law. They record our engagement with the state. And I think any history which makes the state the sole point of its focus, sole moment of its address, leaves out the very many complicated things that we do as members of society, as those that are active in civil spaces, and those that work across many lines that states like to keep intact. Because the state only recognizes a certain form of injustice. Now, we may want to talk of that injustice in many different ways. So I think in that sense, these feminist spaces were very important, they were very creative. This is not to say that they were perfect, far from it. They were not perfect. They didn't sort of grasp with things that today Bahujan Dalit feminists are telling us, that why don't you accept the fact that caste is a default setting for gender in this country? That you cannot speak of a woman's experiences without asking which caste is she from? There is no common sisterhood that binds us. We are equally part of what Dr. Ambedkar called a system of graded inequality. We are all situated differently in the system. We might all suffer, but we don't suffer in the same way. So this doesn't mean we should hierarchize suffering, but it does mean that you might have to have a far more nuanced sense of injustice that pertains to gender and gender location and women's lives and so on. So not that these were things that were all well thought through in the 70s and 80s, but I think to renew that memory of work done in specifically feminist spaces is very useful, just to ask ourselves, why are we not having those conversations anymore? Why are we not listening to other women as we ought to? Why are we rushing with judgment, rushing to sort of get into very abstract definitions of right and wrong? And I do remember, at least from our work in Chennai, that oftentimes we had to sort of deal with instances of, say, family violence, where it was very hard to sort of polarize our understanding and say this woman is completely right and the man is completely wrong. Perhaps the man is completely wrong, but with a woman's group on her side, a woman can see herself through the criminal justice system in a way no working class man can. So confronted in one such situation, this man met us in court and he said, I didn't know court proceedings are so messy or that so much of it happens in a language I can't follow. So there you are forced to confront with the fact that a perpetrator who has been cruel to his wife and to his children is also somewhere within the overall caste and class order in a position where he can't defend himself without having access to lawyers who will sort of for whom he has to pay, having access to a court system which is fairly hostile to the poor. So these are complicated questions. So how do we address them? And I think to go back to our own histories and see where have we traveled, how have we traveled, where have we not gone, and how have we not done certain things right becomes very, very important. And I think one moment like that was reached in the history of the women's movement with two instances actually. One was Gujarat 2002, which was a defining moment for many of us, because you realize that the act of sexual violence can not only be thought of in terms of an individual acting against another individual. It has to be seen in the context of communalized hatred, and it has to be taught in terms of the way conflicts are played out in the realm of gender and sexuality. The second moment was Kunan Poshpara from Kashmir, where an entire village was subjected to sexual violence by the armed forces, and it was well near impossible to talk about Kunan Poshpara in public, because we don't simply have a civic language to indict the armed forces without drawing attention to the fact that they represent the will and command of the Indian nation state, which means you're indicting the Indian nation state. And how do you do that in a civic language? Only by holding the nation state accountable to its constitutional obligations. But to do that without constantly pointing to how those obligations are thoroughly dishonored when it comes to certain geographies in India, Chhattisgarh, Nagaland, Manipur, Kashmir, it becomes a very fraught issue. How do you even talk about this? And I think one of the things we all learned as feminists was when these six young women from Kashmir wrote this remarkable book, and if you haven't read it, please read it, called Do You Remember Kunan Poshpara? It was a remarkable book. It was published 3 years ago in 2016, and you hang your head in shame when you read that book. And the events of August 2019 don't come as a shock if you read accounts of Kashmir going back to the last 20, 25 years. So I think there are moments in our life as a nation when we are forced to confront something which we have evaded coming to terms with. And for feminists, both Kashmir and Gujarat served as a very important sort of moment in thinking through histories of sexual violence and how do you talk about those forms of violence. And I must say that the feminist engagement with Kashmir has been consistent. After Kunan Poshpara, I think it was a group of feminists who carried the struggle for justice for the victims of the Shopian murder cases. To no avail, no justice was to be had in Shopian either. But the question is, what are feminists saying in these instances? They are saying that because sexual violence is never seen in terms of how it affects the people who are the victims of that violence, it is always seen in terms of larger definitions of community, larger definitions of religion or the nation state, you forget the very poignant human dramas that unfold there. Those human dramas are of course shaped by these realities. But how is it we get to a position where these larger realities prevent us from seeing the human drama or the human sorrow that is at the heart of all these acts of violence? And so that, I think, is something that we need to ask ourselves. And perhaps one way of also rethinking that question is to turn our attention to, say, events where we have seen people who were until the day before yesterday neighbors become murderers. People who had lived peacefully with their Muslim neighbors suddenly setting their houses on fire. So how does hatred acquire purchase? Because unless we understand that, we cannot understand our own proclivity to sort of either take the larger picture and leave the human drama out of it, or be so focused on the individual instances of hurt that you don't see the larger picture. And I think that's important also. So I therefore now want to turn my attention to Gujarat 2002, and I must say that it's a moment of great shame and sorrow that this, and for some of you perhaps were very young then, but it's to our sorrow that that entire part of our history has fallen into a black hole. We simply do not commemorate in any meaningful way the horror of Gujarat 2002, of what transpired in Gujarat between the months of February and April across the state, of what happened. And we simply don't revisit that time to ask ourselves, have we done justice by the victims of 2002? Have we even begun the process of journeying towards justice? As a nation, there are individuals, there are groups, there are movements that have done this. But it does not occupy a particular space in our public conscience. In fact, it occupies no space. We've forgotten Gujarat 2002 in some ways. So it's a good thing to therefore go back and look at Gujarat 2002 for the simple reason that how was such hatred made possible? Again, I want to quote Dr. Balagopal. He came back from Gujarat after the events that led to the horror stories we now associate with Naroda Patia and the Gulmohar Housing Society, where Muslims were killed in large numbers and subjected to such acts of horror and violence. And he came back and said, I can understand violence against another human being, but I did not understand the hatred that made people dig up 500-year-old graves and treat them with disrespect. Now, what is that hatred? And he asked this question in extremely sort of a sense of deep dismay. And this man had seen enough instances of state violence in his own native state of Andhra Pradesh. He had seen several acts of what we call encounter deaths. It's not that he was new to violence, but something about Gujarat sort of made him ask this question, how is it that hatred is so easy to perpetrate? What happened in Gujarat? And how is it that an entire state at that moment could turn into this sort of frenzied community which set itself up against another community? So this is a question that he came up with. And here memory is interesting because, first of all, it's dropped out of public memory. And second of all, for all the kinds of violence that took place and the range of incidents that happened, Gujarat has also seen some exceptional acts of justice. And we've forgotten those acts of justice also. One is, of course, the brilliant judgment in the Naroda Patia case, which indicted a range of people, including those we call those who held command responsibility, including a sitting member of parliament, of the assembly at that time. We also forgot the justice that was dealt to Bilkis Banu, another extremely important case. Now, sadly, both these moments of great judgments in the Gujarat case have disappeared so much from public memory that all the people who had been arrested have been let out on bail in both cases. Tremendous crimes against their names. And they've all been let out on bail the last two years, I think, or 3 years. Now, the question, therefore, is how do we engage with something like this? What is the role of memory in all of this? Not only have we let the horror disappear, we've also let go of important milestones in our search for justice. No one protested, no one brought up the question of those judgments again. They were tremendously important judgments. So that is one question. The second is, if you talk to some of the victims in Gujarat, they look at you with wry amusement and they say, why must we remember? What is gained by remembering? Some of us just want to move on. We don't want to sort of remain where we were in 2002. It's good for us to move on. That's one kind of a response you get. A third response is, no such thing happened, you're exaggerating. None of this has actually happened. It's something that you've sort of built up in your own heads. That's also a response you get from Gujarat. So memory is so unstable with respect to something that happened in the not distant past, in the near past, which is like 17 years ago, with so much evidence and fact-finding reports in court judgments, but yet this has sort of completely bypassed our sense of what happened then. And here I want to sort of look at an effort to remember and understand from a very different point of view that took place some years ago, and some of you might be familiar with it. This has been recalled in a book called The Anatomy of Hate by Revati Lal, who was a journalist with Telka at that time, who since is a freelance journalist. So she visited Gujarat some 4 years ago, I think, or 5 years ago, I'm not sure, I don't remember the details, wanting to understand how is it that such acts of horror were carried out by ordinary men and women. That these are not seasoned killers, they are not mentally sort of completely convinced of this, that or the other to have done what they did. Like they are not card-carrying members of the Hindu right in all instances. So who are these people who carried out these acts of hatred? Is there something in them that you can appeal to so that there's a sense of why they did what they did, which we can all learn from? And I think also what Lal was trying to do, Revati Lal was trying to do, was to find ways of talking about remorse. Did people feel remorse? Did they feel bad about what they had done? Is there something to be gained by expressions of remorse? We don't know. Does it matter to people who've lost their loved ones? Does it matter to the perpetrator? But Revati Lal's point was remorse is at least an acknowledgement of another person's suffering, and that's the first step towards reclaiming your own humanity. You know, and I'll be talking about Indonesia towards the end of my talk, but Indonesia's most famous human rights activist, Pramodya Anantatur, he once said that those who carry out vile acts of hatred and violence, it is not just that they diminish the humanity of other people, they diminish their own humanity. And how do you, and it comes from a position of great generosity. The man spent much of his life in an island prison, and he had this to say about people who passed that sentence on him. So I think somewhere those who want to sort of interrogate hatred and violence are also invested in understanding the perpetrators of hatred and violence, and to see if there's a possibility of remorse which becomes the basis for conversation, which can then be taken forward to a place where there's hatred becomes an impossibility. And I think these may sound utopian, these may sound very idealistic, but I think such efforts have been very important in the histories of other cultures and the histories of nations in other parts of the world. So I think in Gujarat, what Revati Lal tried to do was therefore important. And you can read the book, of course, at length, but basically she interviewed hundreds of people, but she narrates the stories of three persons, and all their names have changed. One is a college student called Pranav, who did not participate in violence himself, but who watched, went along with his friends to watch the spectacle of Muslim shops being burnt and looted. His friends participated in the looting. He was from a small town not far from Ahmedabad, and he had grown up in what he considered a regular Hindutva family. And I think afterwards, when... Hindutva family. They were people that were influenced by the messages put forth by the Vishwa Hindu Parishad and the RSS. So, and later on he sort of came to understand the magnitude of what had transpired in Gujarat, and he threw himself completely into rehabilitation work and so on. That was his story. The second story is about a man who was part of the Naroda Patia mob that carried out very vile acts of violence. And he was from a Chara community, which in colonial times was designated as a nomadic criminal tribe, as we know, criminal community. They've all since been in law decriminalized, though, as you know, I don't know if you know this, but in most places, former denotified tribes are often the prime targets of police attack should they want to nab a thief, or should they want to get someone in prison for cases that have not been solved. So the Chara community is completely criminalized by the police force, by the state, and in a very twisted loop, they remain caught in criminal activity. though it might just be petty thievery in some cases, but in some cases not. So the second story is about a man called Suresh, who carried out acts of rape, murder and arson. And he seems to have been both a hardened criminal as well as someone who was deeply craving for attention and affection. You see this violent swing between one way of being towards another way of being, captured particularly in his marriage. He married a Muslim woman, and later on it transpired he had done so for reasons of revenge because his sister had run away with a Muslim man. So he wanted to marry a woman and show her what it means to do such a thing. So they seem to have had a very embattled and a very violent conjugal life, though they had children, of course. And anyway, Suresh's story is the most frightening for many of us. And at the same time, you know that Suresh cannot be seen in isolation. He has to be seen in the context of a culture that encourages those that have been criminalized to carry out vile acts of violence. He was violent, but the relish with which he carried out certain acts of violence against Muslims obviously begs the question, who nurtured that hatred and how was that hatred nurtured? So that becomes an important question, and Suresh's story is a terrible one. There was no redemption there. The only redemption you see is that of his wife, who finally, in a classic move, after years of aggression and suffering in the household, leaves him. So she sort of comes to terms not with the fact that he has been this, she's always haunted by the fact he's done terrible things, but she doesn't know. But when she leaves him because she cannot bear the violence inflicted on her person. So you see this very twisted politics of hatred being played out on women's bodies and on those that this man has been taught to consider as a complete other, so that they don't matter. They're dehumanized before acts of dehumanized violence are carried out on them. I mean, you have to dehumanize a person before you can do things to them. So I think that was something that had been achieved for Suresh by the larger politics of Hindutva, not because Suresh was an ideological RSS man. Far from it. But Suresh had been guaranteed that he can commit these acts and get away with them. He had been assured of the protection of those in power and of reveling in impunity, because Suresh is a braggart. He brags about his crimes. So he has been told you can do these things and no one will catch you. So when he finally was indicted the Naroda Patia judgment, he went berserk. But the fact is, of course, some people get caught. The ones that start this process, even if caught, are kept outside the pale of the law. In any case, the story of Suresh is highly instructive, because where does he fit into a common understanding of a perpetrator of violence? He has not been schooled in a Hindutva school, in a Hindutva religious ideology. He has nothing to do with Hinduism as such. He's not a practicing Hindu like some people are. So where does that come from? So what does hatred rely on? You know, it doesn't rely only on ideology. It relies on its own impunity, it relies on state power, and it relies on working with a group of people who have been thoroughly dehumanized so that they are capable of dehumanizing others. So you see that in Suresh's story. And the third story is the story of, again, a very sad story, the story of Dangar, who is a Bheel tribal. And I think Revati deliberately chose marginal victims, or perhaps they were the only ones willing to tell their stories, marginal perpetrators. So the Bheel tribal man, who's from nearby district where the Bheels are in a sizable community, again, not Hindus, don't forget, Bheels are not Hindus. They are a tribal community who have moved in and out of Hinduism, depending on the historical moment at hand. And he suffered a great sense of self-loss because he was constantly being shown up as this uncivilized person, because he was a tribal in his immediate neighborhood and in immediate context. And so he takes to this project of civilizing himself, as he understood it, through the methods handed out to him by local Hindutva activists. So he becomes a member of the RSS, and his crime was destroying an entire set of Muslim homes, large-scale arson. These were friends, these were people with whom he had commercial ties, these were people with whom he had had neighborhood ties. And how did he do that? And again, is he a convinced ideological person or what? Where does that come from? So this is a question that Revati pushes you to ask. What is the source of such violence and hatred? And what do these ideologies rely on when they push people to commit acts of violence? Some cases it may be straightforward. Some cases it works with existing contradictions, existing antagonisms, and with the fact that there are a lot of people with multiple injustices that they face every day, that when they are pushed to commit an act of injustice, it sort of messes up their lives to a certain extent, but does not throw it off balance because they're anyway caught in a criminal loop. So it's a very sad and poignant story of those who are pushed to commit acts of violence like that. Without exonerating any of them, how do we think of those lives? These lives in particular. And I'm reminded of this very beautiful phrase from the English poet Wilfred Owen, when confronted with the violence of trench warfare in World War I. And meeting, there's this great poem that he has called Strange Meeting, where he meets up with a soldier from the other side, a German soldier. And he says it was a strange meeting, and he uses a phrase, the pity of war, not the terror of war. It's great pity that two people, neither of whom know each other, are willing to indulge in savage acts for the greater glory of their nations. And it's a very poignant moment, because when you look at the lives of Suresh or of Dangar, you see the pity of that hatred and violence. Because what are these lives benefiting by? Suresh's life hasn't changed. He's in prison now. Dangar still has to work as hard as he does to keep himself where he is. So it's not that much changes for them, except that they are dragged into a culture of impunity. They are dragged into a culture of hatred and violence. There are other forms of hatred, no doubt, which are far more proactive, which are far more willing to kill in the name of a thought or an ideology, which are far more prone to considering Dalits or Muslims or those that they don't consider part of the human race as worthy of extermination. And we've heard a lot of that language of violence in recent times. Without a sense of any responsibility, we talk of nuclear war. We know this. We talk of dropping bombs. I mean, without irony also, a bomb thrown in Karachi will destroy Bombay also. I mean, we don't even have a sense of what we are saying anymore. So there is that complete ideology-driven hatred as well. But I think what Revati Lal's book alerts us to is, it's not so much ideology-driven hatred alone, but hatred that is propelled by the Hindu right also draws into its agenda the multiple horrors that our society, even in otherwise so-called normal state, suffers from. This is something that also we need to think about, especially in the context of all the events of the last 2 or 3 months. Because when we sort of imagine things have gone completely wrong in the state of Jammu and Kashmir, what was formerly the state of Jammu and Kashmir, we forget that there is a history to this whole development, which we've all forgotten, because we think that this is an exceptional moment. Gujarat 2002 was exceptional, yes. August 2019 was exceptional, yes. But these exceptions have a relationship to the everyday. They have a relationship to long years of long historical tendencies that we have ignored to our peril. For example, the sexual violence that was carried out in Gujarat, if you didn't have the framework of the caste society, you wouldn't have had it in those forms. Because caste society treats you to other people very easily, as a matter of fact. There are a set of people who are not human anyway, by our everyday standards. I don't want to collapse everyday violence with exceptional violence. But what I want us to try and perhaps think through is, how does my caste everyday make it possible for me to do what some of my fellow citizens did in Gujarat, did in other places, continue to do in parts of India, in the northeast, in Kashmir, in Chhattisgarh. So that relationship is important to, because the reaction to the exceptional cannot define our political agenda to the entirety, that we forget that it has its basis in ways of living that we take for granted that we don't wish to challenge. So how may we rethink those ways of living? How may we sort of think of our own past and our histories in ways that help us renew memories of how we can be decent, civic, mindful citizens. And I think those histories are important, therefore. Histories of struggle, of resistance, or just histories of other ways of being. If you draw a historical trajectory about human existence which starts from, say, the anti-caste movement, you have a very different history of civic decency, which is very different from what you get from other histories. And that history may be very enabling for some of us. If you draw a history of protesting impunity from the civil rights movement, then you have a very different history again. I mean, anybody who's part of the civil rights movement wouldn't have been surprised by the decisions made in August 2019. Anyone who's been part of teams that have gone to Kashmir since 1996 wouldn't have been surprised. But those histories are easily forgotten, and they are important to remember. And sometimes it's important to revisit parts of our past which are painful, like Gujarat, and not sort of say that happened, that's not true of other parts of India. Maybe not, but can we say with absolute sanguine certainty it will not happen in Karnataka, it will not happen in Tamil Nadu, much as we all want to work towards such things not happening again? We can't be sanguine, because hatred does not rely on a unilinear ideological influence alone. It relies on very many things. So that brings me to the last portion of my talk, which is, how do you sort of remember something that you feel, whether you've done it or not, complicit with? And how may you sort of then deal with that past? And here the experience of Indonesia is very, very interesting. Indonesia, as you know, has many parallels with India in terms of size and population apart. It also was part of that great moment of anti-colonial resistance. They threw the Dutch out just as we threw the English out, and they became independent in more or less the same period. What perhaps some of us don't know is Indonesia's elected government was sort of overthrown in a coup barely 15 years after independence. And the country's premier party, one of the premier parties, which was the Party Communist Indonesia, the Communist Party of Indonesia, it was subjected to great terror and murder. From 70,000 to 1.5 million communists were murdered, starting from 1965 to 1968, in a programmatic act of violence. It was not things that happened at random. It was a programmatic act of violence, and it involved what was at that time the nation's major Islamic body called Nahdlatul Ulema. And it was a civil body, it had no presence in government, but government worked through the networks of this Islamic organization to perpetrate acts of killing. And there's a very frightening movie made on this subject called Acts of Killing. So if you can stomach such horror, please watch it. The horror, because there's absolutely no remorse shown towards killing. But what happened in Indonesia in the 1990s was that this police regime, this authoritarian state, was briefly overthrown by democratic resistance. And at that time, there were attempts at going back and looking at many difficult moments in Indonesia's past, including the killing of communists, what had happened in, against other political dissidents, against writers. So lots of reckoning with that past was called for. And the state set up its own Truth and Reconciliation Commission, but that ran into crisis very soon. But there were many civil society initiatives. And one of those initiatives was actually carried forward by young people, younger members of the Nahdlatul Ulema, whose fathers or grandfathers had indulged in acts of violence, and each of whom had grown up with a story of a communist terrorist in their family, in the neighborhood, against whom, in the interests of the Indonesian nation, in the interests of protecting Islam, that person had to be murdered. And we're talking here of almost 1.5 million people being murdered in that fashion. And for the young people who sort of were part of the democracy resistance of the late 60s, it was very troubling and difficult to stay within their families, know that their immediate kith and kin had participated in such violence. So they tried to sort of set forth a moment to bring back those who had been outcasted. That was the word they used very tellingly. They used a word drawn from the caste system. Communists were outcasted. They were considered, the word used in Indonesia was, they were considered untouchable. And that had been systematically done by a discourse which said that they are seditious, they don't have the interests of the country at heart, they are anti-Islamic, their women are promiscuous. And through several public commemorative events, statue building which said the communists had to be destroyed for the Indonesian nation to rise, through school textbooks where they were shown as generally godless. So the state had built this very invidious narrative of this entire body of people who cannot be considered part of the human race, and who therefore had to be killed and murdered. And for the young people who came to terms with the fact that that was not how it was, what do they do with this fact? And it's still not a fully democratized nation. So the youth wing of the Nahdlatul Ulema, which by that time had fallen into disfavor from the government, so they sort of tried to set up conversations between communist survivors and their perpetrators. And this was a very bold thing to do, because both sides wanted to, one side wanted to forget sometimes, one side wanted to brag sometimes. So how do you do this in any meaningful sense? And for them it was not so much a question of rethinking history and saying this moment in my history has been forgotten. They felt that was not going to help them start any conversation, because the Indonesian state had not issued a public apology, it had not spoken of that act as state supported, though there's lot of compelling evidence. So therefore, how do you build reconciliation, if at all? And I think rather than reconciliation, what they wanted to do was to invite those who had been outcasted, who had been placed outside the pale of citizenship, back into some notion of being part of a citizenship group. And here they took their cues from the writings of Pramodaya Anantatur, the great civil rights activist, who basically spoke of the violation of rights, not simply in terms of that they didn't have the right to freedom of speech and all the fundamental rights that we all evoke to argue our case for democracy, but he also included another very, very important thing, saying that you have deprived me of the possibility of my life being lived otherwise. It was not simply that these particular rights have been abrogated, have been taken away from me, but I'm going to read what he actually meant, that the theft of one's rights as a human being without any recourse to a fair and impartial trial is equivalent to pronouncing us dead under civil law, and look at the language he's using, marginalizing us as pareas. It's very interesting the language that they used, or more precisely, is the same as treating us as cattle, no better than cattle. Remembering that it's the duty of all human beings to become fully human, it is clear that all those who steal the rights of another, as well as all those who suffer such theft, have suffered a loss of their humanity. So he was speaking in the name of a shared impaired humanity. So the perpetrators are not human, though they may claim to be. They may claim to be sort of victorious, but that's not the truth. So in that sense, they were trying to invite them back into the community of human beings, from their status as so-called pareas to back to a civil space where the humanity is recognized, first of all. And that did not prove easy. They had to face a lot of trouble. But I think the point of that story is not so much what was achieved. Very little was, in a global sense, because they ran into a lot of trouble with the state. They had to be very careful. They themselves were arrested, as we know happens in many cases. But the fact is that as young people between the ages of 18 and 25, they took on the burden of history, which I think is such a brave thing to do as a young person. Took on the burden of what their forefathers and foremothers had done, and sought in some ways to make reparations. And I think that is something that is so important to learn from in a country where currently, at least, young people are more susceptible to a kind of paranoid nationalism. And I think as young people who have a stake in wanting better lives for all of us, wanting to rethink many things, there's a way in which perhaps experiences of the youth group of the Nahdlatul Ulema in Indonesia speak to us today in our own context in some extremely moving and poignant ways. It is not that they were trying to set the historical record right through their actions. They could not have done that easily. But that they were willing to say that all of us have become dehumanized as a result of some of us carrying out acts of inhumanity against others. So they were redrawing the field completely, saying beyond formal justice is important, beyond going to the courts, how do we sort of repair what has happened to all of us? And as a nation, we have become so impaired. So I think that is something that is important for us to recall in this present moment. So basically, when I sort of started thinking about what could one meaningfully say about the times that doesn't depress all of us, because that's what you immediately feel. You feel, I don't know what this means anymore. Somewhere one feels a sense of hope, perhaps. Though whenever I say hope, I'm reminded of a line from an old poem, hope, that foul, deceitful thing, a poet calls it. But at the same time, others have been there, things have been worse in other parts of the world. So whether it is the individual experience of sexual violence, which finds no purchase in a public realm, no conversation is possible, but where there is so much work to be done in terms of conversations between victims, amongst victims, amongst feminists, by feminists of different persuasions, where you build a certain culture of mindfulness and listening, or what Revati Lal and perhaps some others have tried in Gujarat, where you try and understand the source of hatred. Where does hatred come from? You know, and that I think is a very important question. And I think all over the world people have asked that question in very strong political terms, not in a sentimental sense. For example, there's a fantastic book about the fate of the Jews in Poland called Shtetl, where the Eva Hoffman, she asks this very important question: when does something that seems to be a matter of cultural difference, a subject of jokes, like we have all these Sadaji jokes, jokes against Malayalis, jokes against Tamils or whoever, how does that joke become murderous? At what point does a joke turn murderous? So she tries to trace the history of that in Poland. So it's not that people who have been the victims of injustice always imagine that the perpetrators are all of a kind. And I think the greatest generosity has come from victims, always. So in that sense also, I think Revati Lal has tried to understand if one Pranav can actually manage to transcend the Hindutva limits of his own family and do something, and if Dangar in very many messy ways has been able to feel a sense of remorse for torching those homes. Now, do we take that seriously, and where do we take it from here? And what do we do with that piece of knowledge? And why is that piece of knowledge important? And the Indonesian example shows us that if we are to reclaim our sense of being human in some meaningful fashion, without losing our access to what makes for humanity, it's so important to start thinking about what we owe to a very fractured and terrible past, and how do we sort of work with that past. So therefore, matters of memory and history become very important. And what histories we choose to remember, what do we choose to forget, what is absolutely not mentionable in public. And I think all of these are choices, and all of them have a backstory which has to do with a larger sense of history, which we can all access if we put our minds to it and we have the will to do so, but which we choose not to do, actually. So I would like to stop here, and thanks very much for listening. Take a couple of questions together and answer. Is that okay?
Sure. So we'll take a couple of questions together. So yeah, we'll start with you here.
Hello. I'm a history student and I studied.
Can you just hold your mic?
Hello. Hello. Yeah. I'm a history student and I studied history at the University of Delhi, and I have certain reservations with the kind of narrative that is disseminated. While talking of 2002, how could you so conveniently forget that the community you accused of hatred was first a victim of the same hatred which you probably refuse to acknowledge as hate in the first place? And this is something that I find even in the historiography that is taught at universities. When I was doing my master's in history, I was pretty much apolitical until then, until a professor in my class, who used to keep singling me out in the class and say, "You Brahmin boy, it's because of your ancestors that we are in this mess." And our history curriculum went ad nauseum about caste-based gender injustice in ancient India and was completely silent on the violent assault by Islamic invaders on Hindu, Buddhist, Jain, and Sikh communities, including women from these communities. I just want to ask you one question. What kind of methodology do you practice, and what kind of ideology do you practice that allows one country or even a community to get away with violence and expects another country or community to resort to pacifist measures first before replying or giving them a taste of their own medicine? When you talk of paranoid nationalism and you practice this line of arguments, you're actually making it very easy for me to win a debate on nationalism against you. But yes, I'll be grateful if you could answer that question.
Thank you. That was a really insightful and thought-provoking talk. I had, when you were talking, one of the thoughts that came to mind was that one way that we can is one solution against hatred is to actually lessen the impact, the idea of identity, to transcend the idea of identity in the first place. But at the same time, at the end of your talk, you talked about how to take the burden of history and to make reparations for the past is also to acknowledge the power of those identities and to see ourselves in a certain sense of collective continued responsibility. So I would like to get your thoughts on how do we straddle this idea of being open enough to go beyond and see beyond our identities, but also to take personal responsibility for where we find ourselves right now.
One more question, and
I'll... Is there another question in the audience?
Yeah.
A couple of them, but I'll make them really short. One, when you talk about Indonesia, and when we talk about such incidents, how do we not talk about the U.S. influence, which actually is the reason why this happens? How do we not talk about the insidious neoliberal agenda, which basically creates massive think tanks and, you know, bankrolls the whole operation, where the neighbor turns against the neighbor? Second, if all I have is a wall with a loudspeaker on it, right, where I have this nerd tunnel vision in operation, which is, you know, busy jotting a question down while you're speaking, how do I speak to them?
Thanks for those questions. I'll respond to those and then wait for other questions. To your question about my narrative, I think it comes from a position that's well-founded. I chose to talk about particular incidents that have to do with the last 20 to 30 years. If I had to talk about the long durée of Indian history, we could have had the kind of conversation about how do we sort of look at how Hindus, Muslims, Buddhists were treated in the past, who treated whom badly. And I do think that conversation is something that we can all have. We can all go back and read our history sources. We can look at several approaches to understanding the ancient past and the medieval period. And there are enough number of sources. There are positions to be defended from either which point of view, and we can all have civic conversations about it. But this is not something that I wish to do now, because that's not the subject of my talk. And the point I'm also trying to make is that even if one were to assume that there are enough reasons for Hindus to have felt angered and unhappy, I would still say that the acts of violence that were carried out in Gujarat 2002 are completely regrettable. They ought not to have taken place. And if that's the way Hindu identity and civilization have to affirm themselves, I feel extremely troubled for those who consider themselves Hindus. So let me finish. I think I'm troubled. I would like to sort of all of us to sit back and think a little about where we come from when we get very upset about some things, where we come from when we don't respond to some things, and have civic conversations. I mean, I think those are important. And I don't want to downgrade the importance of what you're saying, but at the same time, I don't think your questions address the details of my talk. You asked me larger, general, global questions. And that is not the subject of my talk today. I'd be happy to engage with it if this forum was about that. But I do feel that any provocation cannot merit a provocation that results in murder, decapitation, and the killing of infants. No culture in the world, no religion in the world, no community in the world ought to endorse it. So I'll sort of stay with that. About your question, of course, one cannot talk of Indonesia in the 60s without the CIA's hand in all of that. Neither can one talk about the role of Indonesia for the purposes of the Cold War politics of that period. But I think what also I want to stress on is, while the larger macro picture shapes and eggs the contradictions that are part of particular nation states or particular geographies, the way they are played out in that nation state, where it's, you have Sukarno being replaced by Sukarto, and the kind of mobilizing of hatred that local cultures made possible. Sure, there's U.S. money, sure, there's U.S. arms, but just as how violence and hatred feed on caste, it feeds on all kinds of resentments we've built over a period of time. Likewise, I think the illiberalism of the neoliberal economy feeds also on certain cultures that have emerged at certain moments in history. I wanted to address that in a kind of focused fashion, because I think if you were to continue to live in that geography, in that national space, while the long shadow of the U.S. really thwarts you and haunts you, you also have to live with the fact that your father has murdered your neighbor's father. And that is a kind of everyday negotiation of which you have to sort of do something about, not at a very personal level, but at the level of what has my culture done that thousands of my kith and kin could have done this. And that, I think, cannot be placed entirely at the you can't make the U.S. entirely responsible for that, though it's responsible in a political economic sense. So I think the relationship between what we call imperialism and the kinds of cultures that communicate the horror of imperialism, you know, and that's something that we have seen even in India. I mean, if the caste system didn't exist, you wouldn't have had the kinds of policies that the colonial rulers came with, and they themselves acknowledge it in many ways. So it's in that sense I pitched my arguments where I did. Now, how do I talk to people is a very good question. I wish I had an easy answer to that one. But I think for anyone, I mean, we are all invested in civilization, aren't we? We are not invested in barbarity. And I think those of us in investment in civilization must talk. And how do we find ways of talking, ways of convincing, though even the moment you want to say something civic, you have great anger in your throat, you know, and you how do you do that? It's important. And I think we have a lot to learn from those who have been at the receiving end of history and who have tried to carry on meaningful conversations. I think again and again, that's what I say. Every Dalit who is decent to me is doing that. Everyone from Kashmir who is saying, listen to me, is doing that. So I think somewhere, I think we also can sort of acquire a sense of resilience from looking at those who've had to be resilient for so long. And you know, I think that's one way of also doing that. But it's a very tough question, of course. I mean, I have no easy answers to that one. And your question about how do we hold issues of identity, how do we square with the past that troubles us, which obviously has to do with identity and memory, with perhaps a culture we need to build that transcends identity. I think feeling responsible for a past is something that proceeds from the fact that some identities are entangled in a very murderous conflict or that bad things have happened. But we are asking that question because we've already transcended those identities. You won't ask that question, you were still trapped within those identities, would you? You wouldn't. So any attempt to sort of ask questions about the past which are critical and meaningful and which makes you feel thoughtful and burdened with it, you've already reached a position where we are inviting ourselves and others into another way of looking at that past. So that's how I would see the first level of your question, first response to your question. But also, I don't want to pit identity against transcending identity. Because I do think all identities have moments of great transcendence. Sometimes they turn parochial. Much depends on historical circumstances, material circumstances. Even Ambedkar, who had no love lost for Hinduism, did admit that the certain aspects of Upanishad philosophy could have served a useful social purpose at some point in time. But he said, it has no meaning for me in present-day India, it's not actionable. So I do think that one can also think about things in a far more nuanced and tentative way, so that we don't set up identity against transcendence.
Hi, thank you for the thought-provoking talk today. You raised three very thought-provoking instances of hatred which are equally deplorable in their own ways, but I just had a question about the instance of memory that you spoke about today. I mean, we live in a world where our attention spans are very short-lived and very fickle, and that makes it really, really difficult to hold something in our memories, in our collective conscience, as you said. What's the way out? What do we do? How do we make sure that, you know, these things are not just, you know, bouncing and skimming past, but actually stay there, and we actually stay long enough to make a difference? So what do you think is the way out?
I have a question of, you mentioned that in the 60s, when the violence happened in Indonesia, where the Islamic right who were doing the violence, they were calling the communists ungodly. And that is a narrative that's happening again, where the communists are again called ungodly. So if anyone who is leftist, basically, are considered like, and that are considered basically to have no connect with God or spirituality. And this is something which I see the right wing taking advantage of, basically, where they are showing themselves to be believing in God. How much do you think the left has done this to themselves, for instance, where there has at least there's a perceived lack of respect for God and spirituality and culture? And means I basically have a question of what is the impact of that lack of belief in God and the ideological left? That's because I'm really confused about it. I've been thinking about this for a long time, and I want to know what the impact is.
Let me just take these two. They're a bit weighty for me. Then I'll come back to those two questions. And there's two more people who put up their hands there. We'll take all three together towards the end. So how do we remember? It's a good question. But you know, students of history, I'd hate to think the present is so exceptional that we can't remember. I'm sure there were moments in our dim, distant past where remembering was hard for many reasons. But I think one of the things is also, how do we do memory work? That's important, no? One way is, of course, to remember the past in meaningful ways. Communication of history. How do we communicate history? And it's at such a low premium in our educational institutions, unless you reach higher education, that we leave it to those who concoct tales and stories to sort of remember how things were in the past. So tales and stories are fantastic, but they are not going to be something that one can share across geographies and cultures. Whereas with history, you can build a narrative that connects many dots together. So history education, I think, is very, very important, and something sadly lacking. And I mean, we all made a huge move in the direction of popular science education. Now, why haven't we done that with respect to history, which is equally important, equally sensitive, and very necessary also? The other thing is through art and literature and music. I mean, I think those are very powerful realms. I mean, because at the end of the day, what affects memory? It's affect, no? I mean, how do you think of something as good and bad based on what you've listened to, what you've heard, the smells and sounds you associate with something? And if consistently you've associated negative things with a certain set of living spaces or a certain kind of diet or a certain kind of music, you're not going to feel warmly about that set of experiences. But if you do have rich sort of layered kinds of works of art or music or literature which remind you that there are ways in which you haven't fully come to terms with something that is not what you know, but which you ought to know, so that you know you learn something, you are open to something. So I do think the realm of affect is very important. And how do we do that? By continuing to sort of believe that these are the hallmarks of civilization, and that it is not weapons, it is not violence, it is not wanting the death of neighbors that mark civilization. Civilization is measured by our own capacity for listening to things that we don't know, for sort of being open to things that we are bothered by, which frighten us, but which we wish to still grasp critically and humanely. So these are things I think, I really think we must all define ourselves as being on the side of civilization. Many people in this country don't want that, but some of us want it. So there's that, I would go with that. Your question about this whole godlessness of communists, I think Indonesia was a special case. It was manufactured to a very high degree. And anyway, that I'm going to sort of not get into now. But I think what has been the communist engagement with religion? It's an interesting question. It's also actually been a very long and complicated history. We are served that history in little capsules. But the engagement of communists, whether in India or in other parts of the world, with religion has been a very rich, contentious one. So if you look at, say, for the history of socialism in 19th century Europe, it was so entwined with notions of utopian futures, with the coming of the New Jerusalem, which it drew on the language and imagery of religion. If you look at the work of certain scholars in, say, a pre-revolutionary Iran, like, say, Ali Shariati and others, you do see sort of the language of religion and the language of justice coming together in some very interesting ways, and socialism. So I do think there's enough around us in a broad socialist sense for us to sort of feel convinced within ourselves that this tradition of thought is godless, yes, but it doesn't mean it doesn't understand the human need for transcendence or the human need to sort of have a kind of cosmological understanding. I think it would be very ridiculous if we surrendered ourselves to what many people imagine communism to be. I think it's a, as a world tradition, it has a lot to offer, a lot that we can pick up from. If we sort of put by the canned version that is served to us and sort of look at more diverse histories and diverse historical experiences of socialism itself. For example, in 1946 in Sri Lanka, there was a group of young Buddhists who wanted to rethink communism in terms of Buddhism. I mean, that's an interesting approach. You agree with it or not is a different matter. But they actually thought that was possible. So I do think there are ways in which one can sort of talk about religion. And I think part of it is also our secular upbringing and mentality that we don't know how to talk about religion. We've lost ways of talking about religion that came so easily to even two generations before us or a generation before us. And I think it's good not to run away from it and say, I will have nothing to do with religion. But see how one might sort of, you know, work with other people's beliefs, beliefs that are inimical to our own, but, you know, and what can I draw from those histories for my own cause? There's been, for instance, in Europe, you had Christian socialism. You know, and there are these variants. I think those offer, I mean, I'm talking like a history teacher, but that's what sort of helps us keep our faith in the virtues of socialism also. So.
You had mentioned Ambedkar a couple of times. So I was just thinking about the pertinence that Ambedkar would have for this evening's discussion, because on one hand, he is seen as someone who is not contributing to and in fact disturbing the nationalist movement on one hand, and the leftists on the other hand accusing him of dividing the working class. And he himself also spoke of separate electorates and all of that. But we also have the other side where he's talking about Maitri. So I was hoping you'd draw some attention to what Ambedkar's contribution was to this kind of conversation. What does reconciliation mean, even as you're fighting for political and legal justice?
One more question?
Yeah. I just want to add a story. So this is from my nephew, who was 6 years old in Ahmedabad in 2002. And his classmate came and said, what's your father doing? My father went to that shop and he has brought TVs and he has brought the fridge and sab kuch leke aaye. Aapke baap kya kar rahe hain? So this is, and this, we are talking about very upper class, upper caste people out here. Okay, so I think there is also a kind of feeling of insecurity against the rise of the Muslims in economic terms in Ahmedabad, and the subsequent ghettoization actually helped in bringing that down. And this is, if you remember in the Chennai riots also, this is something which came up.
Yes.
So do you have something to say?
Yes. One more, that's the last.
No, today's conversation does depend on our understanding of what we consider human rights. Recently, our Home Minister claimed in a Human Rights Commission that Western idea of human rights might not apply in India. And previously, the same argument was used by Tehran representative in UN. So I was just wondering, what are your thoughts of how do we understand human rights
right. In
this religious context?
I'll start with your question. Yes, of course, there's commercial rivalry. There's also the fact that personal grievances get blown into political ones, or you know, specific things to do with particular neighborhoods acquire some other meaning in the context of a capacity for widespread violence. But I still am very troubled by the fact that you can hate with so much ease. Whether there's, you can have commercial rivalry, but what causes acts of such terrible violence? Commercial rivalry I can understand by burning a shop, but to gouge a baby out of someone's stomach, what do you do with that? So I think that's what bothers many of us, and it bothers someone like Revati also, Revati Lal. So, and I suppose for those who would like to see it only as commercial rivalry, they can go back and somewhat try and rebuild their lives. But for many who have been the victims of a different kind of hatred, it's been a very difficult journey also. So that difference perhaps we may want to keep in mind. I'll come to the Maitri question last, because the Ambedkar thing is important for me. But the thing about human rights is a good question. Interestingly, we all talk about what is our version of human rights when it comes to, usually the UN especially, India has sought to define its own sense of human rights when it comes to two issues, caste and gender. It has not signed the protocols for CEDAW fully, and it has refused to sort of accept that casteism is up there with racism. So I think there's a way in which not just the current political dispensation, but previous political dispensations also have fallen back on notions of we have our own civilizational understanding of human rights. Tehran has done that in the past. Some other countries have done that in the past. So what is our understanding of human rights? I mean, in a workable everyday sense, you can cite constitutional obligations, you can cite the UN Declaration of Human Rights and so on. But I think in a far more sort of, in a world historical civilizational sense, it is also our ability to sort of countenance each other's faces even if we dislike each other. I mean, that for me is very important. I don't like your face, but that does not give me the right to hurt you. I don't like your religion, but that does not give me the right to say you have no right to exist. We can talk about why I don't like your face or you don't like my hair. That's fine. But why must it end in murder and mayhem? And where is that is the crux of talking about human rights from the very core of, you know, again, I mean, I keep quoting Balagopal because it was also his death anniversary 2 days ago. And he was one of my mentors. And he would, and when he came back from Gujarat, he wrote this remarkable passage which is so hurtful to recall, which is that, okay, so you don't like Muslims, you don't like their skull caps, you don't like what they eat, you don't like anything, but what gives you the right to kill them? So that is a question we have to take seriously. How do we live with differences, some of which are capable of hurting my sense of what I am, but how do I talk about them, how do I work through them? It's not easy, there are no easy answers. But if you acknowledge that, that becomes a foundation of respect, I think, and mindfulness. And that brings me to Ambedkar also, because as I said, if anyone wants to destroy this Hindu social order, it must be a Dalit activist. It does not serve the Dalit in any meaningful way, in any manner whatsoever. But at the same time, you've had the greatest champion of mindfulness and unconditional maitri coming from within the Dalit community, which is Ambedkar. So what does he mean by maitri? Does he mean something that is fellowship without justice? Far from it. In fact, he quotes the Buddha himself on these matters, and he says, the Buddha was willing to sort of put up with just violence, but only on the understanding that the violence you indulge in to end an injustice is not bred in hatred. That you are doing this because it is the path of the Dhamma. And you will stop when it's not necessary anymore. So I think there's a very complicated understanding of violence at play there. And the second thing is, of course, about delivering justice with detachment. The justice cannot be punitive alone. The justice has to be leavened with a sense of maitri. So these again might strike us as impossibly utopian, but we have to remember that there are people who struggle with such things. And I think it is that struggle that we see in the greatest judicial decisions of our times. Take the Naroda Patia judgment, a 900-page judgment, an amazing document in many ways, where the sessions judge, the special judge actually says, I cannot countenance the fact of people who have suffered so much being made to suffer all over again by being cross-questioned in this manner. That sense of respect for someone who suffered is extremely a high mark of civilization. Poor Jyotsna Yagnik has disappeared from collective consciousness. She was a woman who delivered that judgment. So I think these are important issues to be kept in mind. And maitri as social fellowship is a value that is very central to our vision of living with differences. Towards the end of his life, Ambedkar was sort of completely convinced that you also have to learn to talk to your enemy. And I think that is an important lesson to take away from the larger history of Buddhist thought, if not Buddhist practice. So.
Thank you so much, Geetha.